Hi there, and welcome to The Daily Gardener, a podcast about gardening, botanical history, and literature. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and today is October 13th. Happy Launch into Space Day, William Shatner. Today in botanical history, we celebrate a French writer and poet. An adorable poem called Song of October that's kind of faded into obscurity, but I think it's a good one, so we're going to revive it today. And we'll also hear a forester's advice about pine needles. Turns out there's nothing to worry about. They're just doing their thing. We'll also hear an excerpt from an English writer who's often called the Prince of Paradox. And we grow that garden library today with a lovely recipe as we settle into fall. It's called The Flower Recipe Book. Great title, nice and simple. And then we'll wrap things up with a charming little story courtesy of the Thoreaus. This one comes our way via Sophia, who was the sister and collaborator of her brother, Henry David Thoreau. And in case you didn't know, Sophia was the youngest in the Thoreau family. There were four children born to John and Cynthia. The first was Helen. She was born in 1812. Then came John Jr. He was born in 1815. Then Henry David, the great naturalist and writer. He was born on July 12, 1817. And then finally, Sophia Thoreau. Now, I just ran across Sophia's obituary, which I found very enlightening and also quite touching. So I thought I'd share that with you here quickly as we start the show. Her obituary was published 145 years ago on October 10th, 1876, and it was featured in the Springfield Republican. Here's what it said. 35 years ago, there lived in Concord four brothers and sisters, two of each, two brothers and two sisters, one of whom, a recent graduate of Harvard College, had begun to acquire fame among the transcendentalists and abolitionists by the courage and genius of his writings. John and Henry Thoreau, with their sisters Helen and Sophia, the last, the youngest of the family, were all teachers, or had been, and had displayed peculiar gifts in that profession. But they were all something more than school teachers, and becoming enlisted early in the anti-slavery cause, or in that broader service of humanity, which, quote, plain living and high thinking imply, the death of Miss Sophia Thoreau closes the record on this family, for she was the last of the four children of John Thoreau, and with the exception of an elderly maiden aunt, was the last of the name in America. Now, there are still Thoreaus, it is said, in the island of Jersey, from which her grandfather John had immigrated to Boston soon after the Revolution. But there are now none in America, except for the lady above mentioned. And now the four children lie buried side by side at the foot of their parents' graves in the Concord Cemetery. So a little bit of background on the Thoreau family that'll help you when we get to the end of today's show as we're talking about Sophia Thoreau and Henry Thoreau. You'll be able to place those two together and understand how close they were to each other as the two youngest of the Thoreau children. And then, by the way, I've been remiss because I should have said happy Fontanalia. Today, we say happy Fontanalia because October 13th is the day that the Romans decorated all the fountains and the wellheads, and they used garlands of flowers and bouquets to honor the god known as Fontus, who is the god of wells and springs. And in honor of Fontus, I think today is the perfect day for gardeners to honor the god of wells and springs by draining your sprinkler system, by taking care of the irrigation on your garden. So whether that means storing the garden hose or opening up the spigots or having the sprinkler system blown out, today's the day. I think it makes complete sense We should make October 13th the day that we all get that done, especially if you're in a northern climate. Now, I have had a spigot on the east side of my house here in Maple Grove that has given me fits every single spring because I always need to call a plumber. And so this last plumber that came this past spring said to open it completely up and then to leave it open as we head into winter, because otherwise there's just enough water in there to become a problem over the winter. And it's that freezing, of course, that breaks it, and then it needs repair in the spring. So I'm going to test his theory. I hope that it works. I know it's in a spot where the sun is hitting it in the morning, so I don't know if that's affecting it from a condensation standpoint, but we're going to give it a try. I'm going to follow his advice. So there you go. That's how I will be spending my happy Fontanalia day, dealing with water issues in the garden, closing the chapter on irrigation in my garden. And of course, there's a little touch of irony to doing that today because it's drizzling on and off outside today. So maybe Fontis is trying to tell us something. Who knows? Now, let's see here. Okay, I happen to subscribe to P. Allen Smith's newsletter. And in his latest edition, he shared his recipe for pumpkin turkey chili. Now, those are not three words that I would normally put together, but I have to say that I'm intrigued by this recipe. And here's what he says about it on his website. He said, an Arkansas chef prepared this yummy chili at a Moss Mountain Farm Halloween party, and they served it topped with a little fried sage and sour cream and a thick slice of corn and green chili cornbread. Delish. So let's unpack that a second. First, I usually top my chili with sour cream, so yes to that. And I love having a slice of cornbread with it, but I have never, ever tried a little fried sage. So I'm going to give that a go. What a tremendous touch of fall flavor. I mean, is there anything more evocative of fall than sage? And so I love this whole notion of frying up a tiny little bit of sage and putting it on top of chili. And I'm also thinking I could put that on top of some of my fall soups as well. So I love that idea. In any case, I will share this recipe in the Facebook group for the show so you'll have access to it. It is Alan's recipe for pumpkin turkey chili. You can search for any of those three keywords, and this recipe will pop right up, and then you can make it for yourself and let me know what you think about it. And by the way, as I'm looking at this recipe, he also shares links to three other chilies. So maybe one of these will catch your attention. There's Lean Bean White Chili Machine, great recipe name. Then there's winter squash and white bean fall chili. That sounds really good. And then a vegetarian chili. So lots of good options here. Four different chilies for you to check out if you're interested. Okay, and now it's finally time for today's curated news. Well, I tell you what, today's curated news is an oldie but goodie. It's from 2017 from the website Rural Intelligence. And this is a post that was written by Madeline Sparks, and it's called Fall Garden Outside In. Well, I hung on to this post by Madeline because I thought she did such a wonderful job of capturing this common experience that all of us as gardeners go through this time of year, and that is deciding what to bring in and deciding what we're just going to let go and experience the elements and potentially say goodbye to. So here's how Madeline starts out this little post. She writes, "It's October and my panic is setting in, going from temperatures in the 80s and 90s 1 week to the 40s at night a few days later has kickstarted my annual anxiety about overwintering more plants than I can bring into my small house. And every year I pledge to migrate less of the treasured plants that have provided us so much enjoyment over the summer. But I can't bear to let many of them go. And so without fail, I procrastinate and go through this agonizing exercise every fall with one eye on the weather forecast. And then she writes, succulents, begonias, houseplants, elephant ears, pelargoniums, a huge rabbit's foot fern, and more are now the focus of my attention with the clock ticking. Isn't that relatable? Well, this year, I personally did something a little bit different up at the cabin. I have that outdoor elevated table that I use for potting up my plants, and I just put a burlap skirt around it. So I have to say it's looking totally cute. I love it. But what I did is instead of bringing my houseplants in and then giving them their little wash in the sink and bringing them in that way, I decided that I would do all of the prep outside before bringing them in. Now, why did I do that? Well, number one, I don't enjoy having frogs and spiders hitching a ride into the house. Now, some of the spiders are probably still going to make it in, but I can tell you for a fact that I did not bring frogs into the house, and I had a couple last year. So I like to avoid that if I can. So mission accomplished. But the other benefit of taking care of all of that prep outside is less mess in the house. And now that Max has trooped through the house with his muddy body and paws, I have a big enough mess on my hands. So I'm really extra glad that I didn't add to it when I brought in my houseplants. And you know, up at the cabin, I think I didn't do a count, but I'm betting there's got to be between 20 and 30 plants that I brought in. I totally resonated with what Madeline said because I do have a very large rabbit's foot fern. I was so thrilled to see how well it grew over the summer and how those little rabbit's feet were looking so amazing. They're going to look so sad by the time spring rolls around, but then they'll get another shot in the arm when they go back outside. But I do exactly what she does. I put my Christmas cactus outside. I've got mother-in-law tongue out there. I had a schefflera out there. Lots of succulents. No elephant ears. So I'm going to have to source some of those because I do miss having elephant ears. But now this weekend, when I go back up, now that I've got them all back inside, I'll be doing an indoor spa day for them and just try to get them settled in their new spots right by the deck door in the basement. But now, coming back to this article that Madeline wrote, so full circle moment here, Madeline shares her system for how she chooses what she wants to bring inside and what she ends up jettisoning and just leaving outdoors. So the first thing she does is she has to make the choice. She has to decide who's going to make the cut. And so one of the quick ways that she does this is that if a plant is just not looking good, she does not sweat bullets over that plant, and ugly plants get left outdoors. She's not going to waste her time on that. Then the next thing she does is she grooms them. That's what I did outdoors instead of indoors this year. And I loved that, especially because I have so many pine needles that fall into all of my houseplants. So it was fun to just be able to tip them upside down and take care of all of that. But Madeline is doing the same thing here. She's removing all of the bad leaves, the leaves that have dropped, any spent flowers, checking the soil surface for debris and other things that need to go away. So she's doing her little bit of cleanup here. She gets them a haircut if they need it. And then this next step is what I'll be doing this weekend, which she calls giving them a flush because she wants to flush out all of the minerals and salts that have accumulated with a gentle spray. Now, I like to call that a spa day. I think it sounds a little more friendly. I also use a little bit of Dawn dish soap because I like to really clean up the plants and clean up the outside of the pots as I'm going along. And so that is step three. And then the final step, and here's something else that Madeline does that's a little bit different than me. She writes that about 5 days before she brings her plants in, she tries to deal with anything that might be in the soil. So this would be things like aphids, earwigs, ants, spiders, mealybugs, etc. So she doesn't use chemicals, but she uses organic methods. These environmentally friendly granules work wonders. They're going to kill the bugs and larvae that we can't see that are in the soil. And best of all, it'll continue to work long after you've brought your pots inside. Now, Madeline adds one other little note. She says that she never uses saucers outside, but she does when she brings them indoors. And this is exactly what I do as well. In fact, I just stack my little terracotta saucers up. I make little piles of them around my potting bench. And now that my plants are inside, I have to go back out and get my saucers before I start to water, which is another reason why I wanted to wait until this weekend, because I don't have their adorable little saucers under them. Now, for most of my plants, I'm using terracotta saucers, plain old terracotta pots and terracotta saucers. They're my favorite type of container. But occasionally, if I have a special little plant, especially one on the smaller side, I'll have a terracotta pot, and then I'll find a really pretty china saucer from Goodwill. And then I'll pop that under there just to elevate the plant a little bit, make it a little more special. And I think that combination of the terracotta sitting on top of fine china is a beautiful combination, a total win. So there you go. That is Madeline's method with a little bit of commentary from me. But I love this post. And it's so hard to find someone who's willing to share their entire process for bringing plants back inside, because it really is an entire ordeal. If you have a lot of plants that you're shuttling in and out of the house during the shoulder seasons. And Madeline estimated that she had about 40 or 50 different types of plants that she's doing that with. So that's a substantial number. And even if you think you don't have that many, you might be surprised if you actually do a count. So that's where we all are. We're right in the middle of bringing these plants indoors and then squirreling them away to all the little places that we had them around the house. I keep a big group together in the basement by the deck door. Then I have another little spot upstairs where another smaller group is in front of the patio. And then I keep a few in the kitchen and the dining room. And if you're wondering, well, why does she keep some in the kitchen? I try to keep the ones that are real water hogs that need lots and lots of attention close to me in the kitchen, because I might forget about some of the ones in the basement. And so I've got to make sure that I keep my really tough guys down there. And that's about 80% of my plants. But the remaining 20%, the ones that need lots of babying and attention, those guys are upstairs on the main level where I can monitor how they're doing. All right. If you would like to check out this article by Madeline Sparks, it just might spark some ideas in your own mind about your process for shepherding your plants back indoors. All you need to do is search for the word fall or garden the next time you're in the Facebook group for the show. You should see it right there at the top of the newsfeed. And then you can read everything that Madeline wrote for yourself. Now, if you're not in the Facebook group for the show, just remember that you have a standing invitation. So if you'd like to join the group, all you need to do is head on up to the search bar the next time you're in Facebook and search for the words Daily Gardener Community and then request to join. You'll get three little questions from me about the podcast, and that'll help me make the show better and also help me verify that you're actually a person and not a spammer, because I want to make sure that that group stays very pure, just gardeners, and very on point. So there you go. I hope to see you in the group. All right, it's time for today's botanical history. Here's botanical history for today, October 13th. It was on this day, October 13th, in 1878, that the Chicago Tribune ran a feature article on the French poet, novelist, essayist, playwright, and dramatist known as Victor Hugo. Now, by way of a little backstory, Victor had been opposed to the Second Empire of Napoleon III, and so he was banished from his home country of France, and that was extraordinarily difficult for him. In October of 1855, the exiled Victor Hugo was in desperate need of asylum. And so 166 years ago, this month, Victor arrived on the rainy island of Guernsey seeking refuge. And by the way, geographically speaking, Guernsey is just 26 miles off of France's Normandy coast. And although he had found himself a new home, Victor Hugo was still extremely upset about having to leave France. So much so that he captured his sentiment, his feelings about this in a letter. He wrote, "Exile has not only detached me from France, it has almost detached me from the earth." He felt that strongly about it. But eventually, Victor came to see the island of Guernsey as his, quote, rock of hospitality and freedom. And in the serenity of 15 years of his time on the island, Victor Hugo had found a place where he could truly be a prolific writer. And it was there on the island of Guernsey that he completed his masterpiece, Les Mis. But in the midst of all that writing, Victor also found that he enjoyed working on the only home and garden that he had ever owned. In fact, today the city of Paris has completely renovated Hugo's island garden, which includes a kitchen garden, fruit trees, a large fountain, and what he called his bench of contemplation. That's something that each of us can put in our own gardens. Now, we would just call it a bench, but to Victor Hugo, it was his bench of contemplation. And he loved naming items like that in his garden. In fact, in 1870, Victor planted an oak tree in the middle of his lawn, and he named it the United States of Europe. That's what he called his tree. Now, why did he name a tree the United States of Europe? Well, that's because the tree was symbolic to him, and it represented Victor's vision of European unification. That was his dream, and so Victor Hugo would not have been a fan of Brexit. Well, that is your backstory that has led up to this Chicago Tribune piece that ran on this day back in 1878. And this particular article ends up describing the magnificent view that was beyond the garden and visible from Victor Hugo's second floor study where he worked and wrote. And so now you know how he came to be there and what a rewarding and rich environment it proved to be for his writing. But here's how this view was described by the Chicago Tribune. "It is impossible to conceive a finer view than one gets from this aerial room of glass. At our feet, the furthestmost rocks of Guernsey plunge themselves into the sea. Everywhere, the great ocean. At the extreme point of the port, we view the old castle and the red-coated soldiers of Great Britain. In front, the islands of Herm and Sark bar the horizon like a colossal dike. On the right, the lines of Jersey are vaguely to be seen, always in a perpetual fog. And finally, in the far, far dim distance, the coast of France. But it takes clear weather to view it. This is the magical panorama before which Victor Hugo has worked for 16 years. And then the reporter writes, "When I descended the outer staircase, I found his old face under a huge straw hat in his garden, playing with his little granddaughter and following with rapt attention the frolics of a young George Hugo, who was blowing with terrible effect a tiny boat across the fountain basin." Isn't that sweet? Playing with his grandchildren in the garden? Doesn't get better than that. And it was also on this day, October 13th in 1895, that the Omaha Daily Bee out of Omaha, Nebraska, shared a little poem that was called An October Song. It had been written by a man named Clinton Scollard, who had originally shared it in the Ladies' Home Journal. And I loved this poem for gardeners. It's kind of faded into obscurity, but it is truly a delight for us. And so I wanted to share it with you today. Here's An October Song by Clinton Scollard. There's a flush on the cheek of the pippin and peach, and the first glint of gold on the bough of the beech. The bloom from the stem of the buckwheat is cut, and there'll soon be a gap in the burr of the nut. The grape has a gleam like the breast of a dove, and the haw is as red as the lips of my love, while the hue of her eyes the blue gentian doth wear, and the goldenrod glows like the gloss of her hair. Like bubbles of amber, the hours float away as I search in my heart for regrets for the May. Alas for the spring and the glamour thereof. The autumn has won me, the autumn and love. A marvelous little poem for the month of October. That was An October Song by Clinton Scollard. And it was on this day, October 13th, in 1995, that the Iowa forester Mark Vitosh shared information about falling pine needles. Now, many folks can get alarmed by the amount of pine needle loss and the enormous amount of shedding that can take place this time of year. I know for myself up at the cabin, one day everything will be green and the trees will be just turning color. And then suddenly the pine needles start to drop their leaves. And it's almost like precipitation, like it's snowing or raining yellow pine needles. But what Mark does in this post is that he reminds us that this is perfectly normal, that these trees are doing what they're meant to do. And then he helps us understand this entire process. And he shared it in this post that he wrote for the Iowa State University Extension. And so here's what Mark wrote about pine needle loss on this day back in 1995. Mark wrote, "I've had many calls in the last few weeks concerning the abrupt discoloration of the interior needles in many different types of conifers. Well, the good news is that in most cases, this is a normal characteristic of many different conifers in the fall and not some fatal disease. This time of year, we're used to seeing deciduous or broad-leaved trees showing their brilliant colors, and we don't freak out over that. However, when we see this on conifers, it does not appear normal, and it becomes alarming. But unlike their deciduous counterparts, evergreen conifers only discard a portion of their foliage each fall. For example, pine trees tend to keep 1 to 3 years of needles active, and in the fall, the old needles turn yellow-brown before they shed. The pine species showing the most brilliant color change this year are white, Austrian, and Scotch." And then Mark says that the color change is also noticeable on arborvitae and sometimes spruce. This color change occurs each year, but some years, like in 1995, it is more eye-catching. But as long as the color change is in the inner portion of the tree and in the fall, you should have no worries. So instead of worrying about your pine trees, enjoy the brilliant yellow fall color of your conifer trees. It's entirely normal and natural. They're just doing their thing. All right, it's time for today's Unearthed Words. Today's unearthed words come to us from G.K. Chesterton. This is from his work called The Man Who Was October. October knew, of course, that the action of turning a page, of ending a chapter or shutting a book, did not end a tale. Having admitted that, he would also avow that happy endings were never difficult to find. It is simply a matter, he explained to April, of finding a sunny place in a garden where the light is golden and the grass is soft, somewhere to rest, to stop reading, and to be content. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, The Flower Recipe Book by Alethea Haropoulos and Jill Rizzo. This book came out in 2013, and the subtitle is 100 Magical Sculptural Seasonal Arrangements, and they are beautiful. And so that's where they get the title, The Flower Recipe Book, because they're pulling these things together. And they do a marvelous job. They dedicate the book to their nature-loving mothers. And I thought that was so touching. And then right up front in the book, they introduce the flowers that they're going to be working with. And I love this idea because, as in many cookbooks that share a master list of ingredients, that's what Alethea and Jill are doing with their book. So if you've struggled in the past with flower arranging, if you feel that you can just never get the look that you've been striving for, well, Jill and Alethea are going to break this down. And they have three words that are really their mantra for when they're creating their arrangements. And it's base, focal, and bits. So they start out with this group of flowers and greenery. That's their base. They add in a hero flower. That's their focal point. And then they toss in a little bit of color and character. And that's their bits. And that's what fills out their arrangements. Now, what I love about these two is that they truly love flowers. They start out the introduction to their book this way. And this tells you that they are truly kindred spirits. They write, "A patch of unruly honeysuckle makes our hearts skip a beat. The gnarled and thorny stems of garden roses call to us despite the guaranteed hand scratches. We also have a great respect for the clean lines of calla lilies and the simplicity of a single blooming succulent." Now, doesn't that make them sound like gardeners? Yes, it does. Well, I tell you what, this book is a gem for flower arranging. It is so, so pretty. I think they have over 400 pictures in this book, along with step-by-step instructions. So you really can't go wrong. Jill and Alethea share the basic recipes for all of their arrangements. And just like with cooking, you can follow the recipe or you can add in a few substitutions. If you don't have everything, it's totally fine. You can still end up with a beautiful arrangement. Now, Alethea and Jill are truly masters. In fact, the two work together. They created their own San Francisco-based floral design studio, and their work has been featured in Sunset Magazine, Food and Wine, and Veranda. And it should, because it's absolutely gorgeous. And over at the blog Design Sponge, they left this review for their book. It's a pitch-perfect combination of beautiful and functional, showcasing over 100 floral creations. It breaks down arrangements as if they were recipes, including the ingredients, how-to steps, and ideas for altering arrangements to suit your style. So super, super friendly and hands-on. This book is 272 pages of simple flower recipes that will help you become the floral arranger that you've always wanted to become deep down. You can get a copy of The Flower Recipe Book by Alethea Haropoulos and Jill Rizzo and support the show using the Amazon link in today's show notes for around $6. It's a steal. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. It was on this day, October 13th in 1868, that Sophia Thoreau wrote a poem on the leaflets of a hickory leaf. And the poem that she wrote was entitled Fairhaven, and it was written by her older brother, Henry. Now, somehow, this leaf has managed to survive through the decades. And today, it is proudly housed in the Concord Museum. Now, the poem Fairhaven, that was written by her older brother, Henry, is about the beautiful Fairhaven Hill. It's located near Bear Garden Hill and the Boiling Spring, and it was one of Henry David Thoreau's favorite places on earth. And he often went there to pick huckleberry. Today, Fairhaven Hill is only partially protected by the Concord Land Conservation Trust and the Walden Woods Project. The other part of Fairhaven has been sparsely developed for houses. Now, the poem that Henry David Thoreau wrote, called Fairhaven, has many verses, and Sophia couldn't fit all of them on these little leaflets. She only had four to write on. So she selected four of the verses, and there is one term that I want to highlight for you, and it's a term called Miskatiquid. And Miskatiquid is an indigenous name for the area around Concord, and it's interpreted to mean the place where the waters flow through the grasses. So you're going to hear that word, Miskatiquid, mentioned early on in the very first verse. But anyway, here are the verses from Henry David Thoreau's Fairhaven poem that Sophia wrote on that hickory leaf over 150 years ago. When little hills like lambs did skip, and Joshua ruled in heaven, unmindful rolled Miskatiquid, nor budged an inch Fairhaven. If there's a cliff in this wide world, is a stepping stone to heaven, a pleasant craggy shorthand cut, it sure must be Fairhaven. If ever my bark be tempest-tossed, and every hope the wave in, and this frail hulk shall spring a leak, I'll steer for thee, Fairhaven. And when I take my last long rest, and quiet sleep my grave in, what kindlier covering for my breast than thy warm turf, Fairhaven. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Maple Grove in Wyoming, Minnesota. If you want to read today's show notes, just head on over to thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. And don't forget that you have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for listeners of the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. Last but not least, you can always get in touch by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you tomorrow.